About 23% of our pregnancies were teenagers. All of them are defiant.
Tio waro wa chani, arem tie mo kare kom laten.
My name is Paul Bachbinga, and I'm a Ugandan journalist based in London. As a father and a citizen of this country, I've been horrified by the stories of sexual violence and incest involving young girls in northern Uganda.
It was very tough because some of these things I had not experienced them. A father having sexual intercourse with a daughter, a granddaughter.
There's nobody who can really support the person who has been raped. To me, I look at this justice as a weak justice.
This region suffered a 20-year hideous insurgency.
About 25 dead bodies myself.
I describe it as the war was fought in the body of the woman and the woman became the battlefield.
The war ended about 15 years ago, but is a post-conflict legacy just as horrific as the war itself? I was born in Uganda, and most of the early part of my life was spent in Uganda. After the recent lockdown due to the COVID pandemic, there were these horrific tales that came out of this country about an increase in teenage pregnancy. But there seemed to be even more tales that were coming from northern Uganda, particularly about abuse of young girls. And I was interested in finding out what exactly was happening here in the underbelly of this society. That is why I came to Acholi in northern Uganda. The population of this region is just over 2 million, and with close to 70% of people living in poverty, it's one of the poorest regions in the country. Gulu, roughly 330 kilometers from the capital Kampala, is the commercial and administrative city of the north. I'm starting here at the Regional General Hospital's antenatal ward.
Good girl, chol, chol, chol,
and old.
Chol, baby, old, chol, chol, chol. From the last financial year's report, about 23% of our pregnancies were teenagers. If I'm talking of teenage mothers, all of them are defiled. They're teenagers, they're not supposed to be pregnant.
In Uganda, defilement means unlawful sexual intercourse with a girl below the age of 18. Which is the age of consent here. So, a quarter of the babies Dr. Baifa's team helped deliver safely are born to child mothers.
Teenage pregnancy is a challenge in our system. A young mother alone is a complication in itself. She has been in labor since yesterday. So, deliver by sister.
If a girl is under 14, or her abuser is a carer or HIV positive, or a repeat offender, it becomes aggravated defilement. Incest is a separate crime under the penal code.
Because they are young, their body is not developed to handle a delivery, a pregnancy, and all. And you'll find that young mothers are the highest proportion of those dying of protracted labor. The younger the mother, the more the complication.
A harrowing report published during the pandemic reflected a 300% increase in girls aged 10 to 14 giving birth in Uganda as a whole. The figures are highest in rural areas, so I'm heading out of the city to Kitgum district. It's a Sunday morning and the joyous sound of the church service emanates across the countryside.
Oh.
I'm meeting a group of women who have met through their church and have joined forces to help their community.
Dana Magamio Kony, but Mege Mege Magiti Kipero Mapari Paddy, Gang Macamege. Pay Lou and Ginamok again. Cause Mani Kubeli, Kibabani, Kipeke care my can, a conyo in. Chiwango, Kanyo Kani, Bino Konyin, where in.
Grace is visiting a little girl who's 8 months pregnant and living alone. They think she's 11 or 12 years old. This child's parents' cassava business failed, so they return to their village far away to farm to try to provide something for their family.
By the time I go check a food charo, go where I'll tell you. Can get it out. Just bear a bedo. Gap mono bedo can get kilunyodo.
No one knows who the father is or what happened here. We're only allowed to film here with the local community leader's support. David is in local parentis and wants to raise awareness of the sexual violence happening here.
She was left here because here is a little bit nearer to the schools. But the unfortunate part, the next room here is where people drinks. That alone has exposed her to a lot of challenges. When she looked at other fellow girls who are not pregnant, she cried. That is our lifestyle. In a week, we always have like 3 cases of defilement. Sometimes when we get the perpetrator, we have to tie them with the ropes and take them and escort them to the police. But they don't bother to follow it up. There's nobody who can really support the person who has been raped. To me, I look at this justice as a weak justice.
It's odd to be in this place, even heartbreaking. Her parents have left her here, ostensibly for her to be able to get a better education. But here she is, pregnant, alone, frightened. I'm utterly disgusted and appalled, but also it gives me a sense of helplessness. What does it mean for the next generation? Is this really the new normal? I grew up in the South, and in many ways, it was another world. A war, an insurgency ravaged this region for 20 years, known in the West as Kony's War.
Once again, the town of Gulu is at the center of fear and insecurity.
The LRA often threaten that they will come and take revenge raids on children that are
sleeping. A lot of prisoners of war, a lot of ammunition.
Joseph Kony, an Acholi, led the Lord's Resistance Army, a rebel group which wanted to overthrow the government.
Lord's Resistance rebels in northern Uganda have been active again.
I've seen about 25 dead bodies myself.
He was infamous for his inhumane treatment of those he abducted, maiming, cutting off lips and limbs, forcing people into submission through fear.
From Sudan, in bands of several hundred, attacking villages.
Almost every child here has lost a parent to the violence. They're taught to know Kony's name and to fear it.
It is estimated that 40,000 children were abducted, and 1.7 million people lived in internally displaced persons camps created by the government in theory, to keep people safe. It wasn't until 2008 that the war came to an end, though Kony's whereabouts are still unknown. The war here is a highly relevant context. Pamela Ngwech runs an organization working with the community post-war.
Living within a toxic minefield environment had a long-term effects on the community. People are used to seeing dead bodies, people are used to seeing death. People begin to think that sexual and gender-based abuse seems to be not the highest level of abuse. Sexual abuse was used as a military strategy by the LRA team. I describe it as the war was fought in the body of the woman and the woman became the battlefield. One woman described a situation where she was abducted with her three sons and two daughters. And then they say, "We want your son to sleep with you, or else we shall shoot him now." But the son said, "No, over my dead body, I cannot sleep with my mother in front of you." But the mother begged the son and said, "Please, you need to live longer and you need to stay alive."
Pamela's organization is trying to counter a warped psyche ingrained. Christopher is one of over 1,000 men who, having had violent pasts, have been trained to help change the way women are treated.
Actually, come in 1996. Apart from Matkohan, Karkan, Luan Bandu, Luanagan, Kawai Koko, Tango, Winuloko, and Madu. So Kar Madu Machao, Bir Madu Yer, Madame Chan, and Andu Mira, where Kirkwa Matia, okay.
A map can't yet do a man. And you're the man I'm a bit doing. No mere duke on a name, a baby on all that.
And Kuoma Dan Birke Camp would do give a chin gangan. Look in what you wanted Dan would Birke one not here. Cause I will make a wear muga wear, a very what a. And okay, Tony, you know, child edit families did water. No, the thing you took a walk and giving it to my dear. Dan would make a lacking point by Ludir can give me.
The LRA war brought further challenges for thousands of abductees who returned. Many children born in captivity simply don't know their parents and may have been born across the border. In the Ugandan constitution, they are considered stateless. They don't exist on paper. Pamela's organization works with returnees.
They miss out of opportunities. So we did skilling of this girl. Some of them decided to choose a baking academy and they learned very many skills in baking and now they are using it as a business for their own empowerment.
Fon mano mikyo pomugara ne. Ukonya jimi anonyo business mabitimo ni. Vonya onyi kimo ba. Aramuno ngika mama ramko ye keno enda tiano me.
Eunice's mother and aunt were abducted by the LRA when they were teenagers. Both women bore children in captivity. Eunice's mother died at the hands of the LRA, but her aunt, who had twins, took Eunice as her own child too.
I tell a daughter, Lotini. Rude a D, a deck, a ching an. My daughter, Lotino, my Megan Emmanuel no bear a bear a chill, a chill, Magalunya no peony. Guano ruino. Madara Bielo, a chilling air. abiero atinyo pas kay dok chunya ko bano madong ana chikangwen magawana den kora ariyo kala teni pacha ngani ngo kara mariyo la wara chel beno wate evalin gonya teni ngene ti gonya la ten kinya ti teka neno la ten ma mega bene buono ruenyo ta de bino kwanya ngota ten ma mega ni ti da ga neno pala me ane ti gwa ton ta wa ne ni ro ba mi ene ni ngo ko ja piona.
After a decade in captivity, they were released to a fractured community. It took years for Eunice to know her true story, which has taken a toll.
Dano wino, laka yet pa dano kin community, me tweetin maloy ma ango, waripe wani kirni. Chiketa wati ni bet kinwang twin, ni dongpe, tawate, yin, na yin na tena, ando an mamani.
Chika an mo wacha, a bit of a lure to kick warm, a bit of a war, kirma, lure to take a quan, and where pick a quan could teach. No, there, Pacuo. Then you are killing a chomo. Ero come, I know. Gachan, poor Kanya kill a tena. A thing a do gang.
Eunice's baby is living elsewhere with another aunt. We are told there are too many children here to look after properly. But a small hope lies in her baking business.
We are doing a no. Baku tuk gani kome. Kenen guakti kan ngera, ane anu kir ma ente kuo kere, bae beru ne tin hini, chino beru hiyot erup.
It's over 15 years ago that the LRA were formally driven out of northern Uganda, but the after effects of the 20-year-long insurgency continue to ripple through this society.
The stories that I've heard from these two women are heartbreaking. I can't imagine how Eunice copes with the multiple layers of loss and rejection. She's one of so many with scars that are incomprehensible, and the lack of any justice or legal redress seems a thread through society. Whilst we have been in the community, I've been put in touch with a lawyer from the NGO Caritas. Just like Pamela, her experience has defined her career path.
Unyuma tute, lubu kita chao watikede, ngoma defile me anobedu. Ngati mora mwachiwa ngoma defile me anobedu?
Growing up from Gulu, I saw so many children getting defiled, and most of those parents did not have the resources to pursue the justice that their children deserved. With these sexual offenses, the perpetrators are always people that are known to the victims. In most cases, it's a relative. When I just started this work, it was very tough because some of these things I had not experienced them. A father having sexual intercourse with a daughter, a granddaughter, it was very traumatic for me. And I think here and there I would break down, like literally break down.
Bien la tien matiri rugo ba ma raj mene bene lingo ya da no te mier ka mier pe pe en fait rugo ba ma waro icho bene.
Eunice is alerted to some of the cases of defilement and gender-based violence that do get reported to the police. Today she's taking us with her as she visits the family of one of the most acute cases of sexual violence and incest she's been dealing with over the years.
We're going to visit a family of a child who was defiled when she was about 3 years. Yes, when she was defiled. She was defiled by her stepfather's brother. The mother didn't notice until her walking style, everything like that changed. And then when she asked the girl, she finally disclosed the person who had, you know, sexual intercourse with her. In most cases, the family tries to make sure that the issue is handled within the family without having to, you know, seek recourse at police or take legal actions.
Negen gen gimeti loko kugira wera madong loko dora tagati dang neno kom en chidong kwanyo en rako pingu chie rako ot.
Even when a case is taken up by the police, justice here seems to come at a price.
Ji police chara penyani megu yini tie ki chane maromo transport. Awajani chani ana pe ki chane moy ken maromo transport. Mana dong en gen karata sa yedong ku buja ami na kon me transport. Umera ted mabuj matie apet mabuj.
You have to literally pay your way to get justice. You have to pay money for fuel to have the suspect apprehended. You're supposed to provide feeding for them while they're still at the police station, because at the police station, they don't have provision for feeding. When you go to health centers, medical persons don't allow to fill police forms without being paid. When you look at the community that I am in, the poverty level is very high, so it's a big challenge.
Medical and police reports confirmed the abuse, and on top of everything, this little girl was infected with a sexually transmitted disease. A tragic piece of evidence in this case. The suspect was held for 6 months, but because some legal due process wasn't followed correctly, he was released on bail. This mother simply hasn't the means to keep pursuing.
No court where you, it where you end with your butcher, and na me on a locke no putum.
This particular case is not the only case of defilement being done on a very young girl and she doesn't get the justice that she deserves. We have a number of them. I think it says a lot why most people don't have trust in the justice system, because if a four-year-old doesn't get the justice that they deserve, what happens to a 16-year-old? Or what happens if you don't have money? There is a lot of corruption. People don't fear committing crimes here because they say if you have money, you get out. That is what is happening. That is what happens.
Not one of the instances of sexual abuse that I've seen here have been successfully prosecuted. And hearing that the victims must pay the police and supply the alleged perpetrators meals in custody beggars belief. The head of the police force here agreed to meet me.
Now, with the corruption, it has been a general perception that police officers are corrupt, but not all are corrupt, just like any other institution would be. We have good ones and bad ones. We are not supposed to ask a victim to pay for our services, but sometimes I should accept that we can run out of fuel. Because we're given per month. So there's that possibility that maybe at the time when the crime has been committed, maybe the police officer at that particular station has run out of fuel.
If the police really have no fuel to arrest child abusers and hold victims to ransom, what hope for justice here? Perhaps the Acholi region's Minister of State for Justice can shed light.
I can't deny corruption,
corruption is there. It's at all levels, even at ministries level. We have laws on defilement, we have laws on incest, but somehow, again, people just go behind the law and bribe police, and then police says, okay, go and settle it at home. There are cases which have been prosecuted, but the number is not high. From the cases which were reported, only 6% reached court. That's what they told me. Defilement has a consequence. Imprisonment and fine, imprisonment of 20 years even. But it's difficult to enforce somehow.
I don't know whether to be grateful for our honesty or horrified at the acceptance of the hideous status quo here. We have been unable to get confirmation of whether any case of defilement has actually been successfully prosecuted recently. It seems that Choliland has become a praying ground where abusers are on top of the law. Those who can pay, win. I hold some optimism that women like the mother buddies, Pamela, Eunice, Dr. Bifa, will help many caught in a hideous web. But is it a drop in the ocean? Surely, it's time the government woke up to what is happening if the future of girls here is ever going to be bright.